First of all, I'm Pier, and I'm a data scientist at the SAS Institute, which is a big company about all about data analytics, which has been around for more than 40 years. And we cover many different aspects of the whole data science and data analytics stacks, from getting your data to pre-processing to creating models and deploying them really easily using user interface, which are really easy to grasp for newbies or for data analysts. And at the same time, we also provide our own programming language like SAS code. But apart from that, we also provide APIs so that you can code in other programming languages as Python and R. So apart from my daily job at SAS Institute, I'm also a writer on towards data science, for which I've been writing for about 2 years right now. And in my spare time also, I'm a freelancer, so I have my own website where people can contact me for activity or for suggestions in general, so that to write articles or for giving presentations. And before that, I did a bachelor degree in electronic engineering and a master in artificial intelligence at the University of Southampton in the UK. So to quickly introduce you to what we're going to cover today, this is the agenda. We're going to first give you an introduction to causal reasoning, what it is and why it is useful in machine learning, and how it can be applied. Then I'm going to give you an introduction to how can you use basically data science through modeling simulations when you have no data available for you, so how to solve these kind of questions. And then I'm going to show you a case study using epidemic modeling as an example, because of COVID. This has been a project we developed throughout 2020. And then I'm going to also give you a practical demonstration on how this program has been tackled and how the dashboard has been created so that people can usually make use of this kind of analysis for your own purposes. So to get started, causal reasoning in machine learning. So nowadays, machine learning technologies rely just on correlations between different features. Although this approach can possibly lead to wrong conclusions, since correlation do not imply necessarily causation. And therefore, you have to pay lots of attention in order to try to find out spurious correlations which are not right, and then get an understanding of how really your model is working or is making predictions. So nowadays, when you use machine learning models or deep learning models even more, they really lack of three problems. One is explainability, like shown in the previous presentation. Another one is robustness, and then data dependencies. So by robustness, we mean that trained models might not be able to generalize to new data, and therefore will not be able to provide a robust and reliable performance into the real world over a constant amount of time. So when you have these kind of problems, usually you create a model, you deploy it in production, it works well the first few days, and then after the performance goes out of a cliff and goes really bad. And therefore you have to constantly keep a track of how the model is performing in production, then they have to retrain it, redeploy it, and so on, doing this before they're going through a vicious cycle. And then explainability, we mean that complex deep learning models can be difficult to analyze in order to demonstrate the decision-making process. So if you make use of linear classifiers, such as decision tree, for example, you can clearly see how the model is working and work through the process. But if you are working with complex deep learning models, especially in ambits which can be quite sensible, such as hiring or medicine, law, and so on, that make really important decisions, then you really want to be able to explain how your model is working, especially if some people might question your decision. So, and that's also part of the GDPR agreement made by the European Union, that they provide a clause called the right of explainability, which means that if someone has been given a decision, for example, ruled by a court, the court has the person who had the judgment has the right to ask why this decision has been made and has to be given an explanation. And then the last point is about data dependencies. So obviously, in order to create deep learning models which perform well and that can be used in production, you need to have lots of data. And at times, in order to solve these problems, you might use techniques such as data augmentations and so on, but at the same time, you always need to create first data. And therefore, in order to create this model, you also need to require lots of computational resources and time. So you might need to have, for example, GPU instances so that you can run your model on for several hours, and of course you monitor your company and cost time for yourself for the time to spend going after this model. And while we talk about causal reasoning, we think that basically through embedding some form of causal reasoning into your machine learning models so that you create a sort of a knowledge base, you can be able to speed up this kind of process so that you can train models requiring many less examples, such as, for example, how we as human species work. So, for example, if we have to classify images, we can, as humans, we are able to perform this task just by examining a few cars, and then you can generalize on that to try to get guess if you see a new model of a car, if it is actually a car or not. And then you don't need to feed in into your memory many different instances of cars. And basically, by embedding causality into your model, you want to do the sort of the same situation. So you want to provide some form of context which your model can then understand and make decisions based also on the context and environment. So in order to try to tackle this problem, Julia Perl, which is the author of a book called The Book of Why, has created this form of causal hierarchy, which he thinks that we should all follow in order to try to create models which are truly able to understand causality. So according to Julia Perl, at the moment we are just at the association stage of this hierarchy, so at the bottom. And while we are at this stage, we're just able to see associations between variables and ask ourselves questions such as, what is, how will seeing this type of variable change my belief into another variable, and so on. So that means that basically you are basically just working using correlations and trying to compare variables and then making inference through that. The next stage will then be in order to try to actively work with your data. So intervening on our data and asking questions of the type, what if? So you might take a control variable, you might have different variables, and you decide to select a single one which you think can be important and control it, and then controlling this variable vary the other ones and see how it actually affects your model, your predictions, and your environment. And finally, the last stage of this hierarchy will be to ask herself some form of counterfactual or retrospective type of question. So what if I acted differently on a certain situation, and so on. So in this case, the model will be able to retrospectively be given some form of past data about past activities such as fraudulent transaction and so on, and then examine the data and actively work on augmenting the data so that artificially so that you can understand if a given scenario, a different scenario, what if changing one action, what kind of scenarios would that lead to, basically. And one simple example in order to exemplify how easy it is to make wrong assumptions about models and how different correlations works is through the Simpson paradox. The Simpson paradox is a phenomenon in probability statistics in which a trend appears in several different groups of data, but disappears or reverses when these groups are combined. And this paradox can basically be resolved just through the use of causal relations and through statistical modeling. So I'm now gonna show you a quick example of a couple of graphs in order to quickly exemplify how does this work and why do we should care about it. So as an example, let us consider a thought sample experiment, which we carry out a research study in order to find out if doing physical exercises can help or not reduce cholesterol levels. And we're now starting to examine the obtained results. First, we divide the population into two main categories based on the individual age, under or over 6 years old, and then plot the cholesterol levels against the number of hours the subjects exercise per day. So as you can see here, we have these three graphs, and they all exemplify under 60, over 60, and the total experiment. And by examining the results of the first two plots, we can then infer that exercising for more hours a day can then lead to an overall reduction in the cholesterol levels, if you look at the graphs. And this supposition can also be reinforced by examining the overall trend of the best fit line inferred through linear regression, which gives us quite a strong negative Pearson correlation score in both cases. At this point, reassured by our derived results, we can then try to repeat the same analysis, looking at observation, this time the whole population sample, as shown in the rightmost graph. So, and you can see that in this case, we are forced with a completely different and contradictory scenario, and we have a positive correlation, implying that more exercise can lead to increased cholesterol levels. This type of scenario is commonly known as the syndrome paradox, and takes place every time we have some form of correlations which points in a direction when considering a subgroup, and points instead in the opposite direction if considered as part of the whole group. In order to unveil the reason behind this type of mechanism, we then need to try to go beyond the provided data and think about how our data was generated in the first place to cause this outcome. For example, considering what unknown variable or missing variable might prevent us to see the full picture. So to summarize, you can see clearly that in the first graph, you have a negative correlation showing that the lower the amount of hours you exercise and the higher you get your cholesterol levels, and the same trend also for the second graph. And then once you put the under 60 people and the over 60 people together, you get the Pearson correlation, which gets completely reversed. And instead of having a negative correlation, so you get a positive correlation. So in this simple scenario, our missing component in order to try to solve this problem could be different potential variables such as individual comorbidities, diet, and age. So if we decided to take a closer look into how cholesterol levels vary with greater age, as shown in the second graph, repeating the same analysis done in the previous slide, we can then clearly see how cholesterol levels are strongly positively correlated to individual age. And from these results, we can then deduce that cholesterol levels are more likely to increase with aging and lack of exercise. There is, therefore, there was this causal effect relationship between three variables. And because we were just examining two of them, we got a complete opposite results just because we missed on the third variable. And therefore, in order to try to quantify the benefits of how exercising can help into reduce cholesterol levels and overcome the syndrome paradox, we then need to make sure to run our experiments while having a fixed value for the age of the subjects and therefore controlling the variable, as I mentioned before. So I hope that it came clear for how short at the time I try to explain this. And if you have any questions in the chat, feel free to answer anytime or also during the Q&A session. So moving on, we can then see how causality compares to explainability, which has been a topic we covered in the previous session. So one of the major trade-offs in modern machine learning is that is the one between the performance against complexity. So usually, if you have a really complex problem to solve, you need to use complex tools and complex deep learning algorithms in order to overcome it. And this shouldn't be obvious the case. And you should always aim to solve a complex problem with the easiest possible solution so that you can quickly debug your code or get a clear understanding of when something is going wrong. And therefore, from a business case point of view, you want to have the performance which is as high as possible, but you also want to reduce the complexity when it's unnecessary. And therefore, when we consider deploying models, they usually perform much better than linear classifier and regression techniques when comparing this kind of difficult challenges which you might feel is facing in a company. But and therefore they are also referred to as black boxes. And these type of models working processes are more difficult to comprehend and to estimate the importance of each different features when related to each other. On the other hand, simpler and less accurate models such as decision tree and linear regressions are instead regarded as white boxes and can be much more interpretable. The two of the main measures which can be used in order to estimate the the explainability of a model are the linearity and the monoticity of the model response function. And one of the key differences between explainable and the causal AI is that the former aims just to understand how a model might come to a prediction by greeting the provided features, while the latter is designed to undercover the process governing systems and therefore analyzing and creating insights from them. In this way, causal AI can be used in order to answer common respective type of questions and system design types of questions, providing real business values to organization, therefore covering, for example, the EU general data protection regulations, right to the principles. So, say that we can now move on into the a more practical side of the demonstration, therefore covering the other aspects about how to actually create causal models which can then be used. So, just a moment, the slide moved around. So, in this case, we can see that when we talk about modeling simulations, we mean that this technique is typically used when we are trying to solve a problem in data science without having necessarily any data available. So, as explained by George Box, which was a statistician, he said that essentially all models are wrong, but some of them are useful. And this can be applied to any contemporary machine learning or data science problem, since that you can get models which perform really closely to the target variable, but at the same time, it's almost impossible to always achieve 100% accuracy. And therefore, you're able to some extent to simulate the sort of the environment in which they will be deployed on, but never reaching an optimal performance, which is equal to 100% always accurate. So in order to create models, usually there are two different types of approaches, and this can be mathematical models, which make use of mathematical symbols and relationships in order to summarize processes. And an example mathematical models are compartmental models, which are used, for example, in epidemiology in order to create different epidemics or pandemic scenarios, as we will see later on. And the other type is process models. So these type of models are instead focused on coding from scratch, a list of steps handcrafted by a designer, which should be a coder, a programmer, or a data scientist, in order to represent an environment. And one of the main applications of process models is agent-based modeling, but also the type of environments which should be in some form of reinforcement learning or also gaming, when you have to simulate an actor moving into an environment in order to solve complex tasks. Therefore, when we consider these kind of tasks, it's really important that we try to focus on working without data, and we create ourselves basically an environment through which we can generate data. And once we have data and an environment which you can play on, you can then train also machine learning models and so on if you need to. So modeling and simulations are commonly used nowadays in many different fields and ambits, such as finance, through Monte Carlo simulations for portfolio optimization, medical and military training, and also threat modeling, when you have to identify, for example, malicious activities on servers. And some of the main uses of simulations are to verify, for example, analytical solutions, experiment policies before creating any physical implementation, and understanding the connection and the relative importance of the different variables composing a system. For example, you can modify the input parameters, examine the results, and then calculate the distance between your previous outcome and the new one. As a result, these properties make the modeling simulation paradigm a white box approach to predict future trends, and therefore it's more desirable than, for example, using more complicated black boxes approaches. Once having run many different simulations, tested all the different possible scenarios, we can then make use of the generated data in order to train our machine models, and then go on into applying policies and so on into the real world. So as I mentioned before, one example of mathematical models are compartmental models. And these are used, for example, when trying to simulate epidemiological scenarios. So in this case, it's assumed that each individual in a population is assigned to a compartment. So in this case, you can see on the screen, there is a simple SIR model, which is composed of three different states or compartments. And all the different individuals in the population can be in one of these three compartments. So the first compartment is called S for susceptibles. So these are people who live, for example, if you want to simulate the spread of a disease in a city, for example, you have all the populations, the population will compose all the citizens of the city. And the people who fall into the susceptible compartment will be the people who didn't have yet the disease. And then these people can transition. Yes, they can stay in their box, in their compartment, or they can transition to a different state, as shown in the graph. And then as you can see, the transition between one state to another is recreated by a set of mathematical equations, which you can see on the right side in the form of these three differential equations, which basically represents the rate of change between one state to another, the probability of changing from one state to another, and the number of individuals which are in populations with respect to the number of individuals which are in the compartments and the next compartment. And then you can convert that into the equations, and you can go on and design different simulations. So during the simulations, then individuals can be then free to move from one compartment to another, depending on the dynamics of the model. Some examples of common departments in epidemic modeling are susceptible, exposed, infectious, recovered, dead, vaccinated, and so on. So in this example, you can see that there are just three compartments, and that's susceptible, infected, and recovered. So in this case, you might have a disease which is, for example, not too bad, like fever, which you have people who are susceptible, then they can get infected. And then once they are infected, they are recovered and they gain some form of immunity for a limited amount of time. Then if, for example, you want to, as I mentioned before, you can also add more compartments and makes this model much more complicated. So in this case, for example, you might have that not all the people recovered, but some of them die, and therefore you have a separate compartment, and therefore you have some form of conditional logic between that. The infected stage and either the recovery stage or the death stage. And then you can have even more compartments, such as if people get vaccinated, they can look back to susceptible and not to be infected. If people get medications, you can do the same. So, or some form of prevention techniques, such as adding boxes for simplifying people doing quarantine. So if you create these kind of boxes, you can have that if you are infected, but you are just isolated, you have zero transmissibility to other people, and therefore the rate of moving between one stage to another goes down. And these models, therefore, as you can see on the right side, they are mainly decided using either ordinary differential equations or also with some addition of stochasticity as well, if needed, in order to simulate the environment. And converting the equations into diagrams can be a great help in order to try to understand how the equations work and what can be the actual possible different movements between states. So once you plug in your differential equations and you simulate them against time, you can then go on and create nice graphs and simulations of how this disease might spread over a city, as I mentioned before. So in this case, you can see that creating a simple graph in which you have the number of cases on the y-axis and the number of days on the x-axis. And you can see that initially all the populations, apart from one or two people, were part of the susceptible compartment. And as the disease spread, the number of infected reached a tipping point. And then once more than about half or the population got at least infected, and the exponential trend converted into a logistic trend. And you can see that then once it reaches inflection point, the cases goes down because once you have infected at least half of the populations, obviously there are not many people you can infect anymore, and therefore the number of cases seems to go down. And then you can see the tender decimation, because we just have these three different compartments, all the different people then are moved from being susceptible to have recovered for the disease. And when you, these kind of graphs are typically used, for example, now with COVID by governments in order to aid decision makers in order to understand what to do and how to do apply restriction in order to limit the amount of cases. So obviously, if you don't want to overwhelm the medical sector and the hospitals, you want to sort of bring down this green curve and maybe squish it to be longer period, but down, so that you don't have, you are not overwhelming the hospitals with too many people. And obviously, if you have more number of infected that needs hospitalization than the number of places available in hospitals, you will have some people necessarily dying because there is just no medical support for them, and they will survive instead of the support. So using compartmental models is definitely one of the good way in order to represent these type of states. And then from there, you can also see that you can calculate R0 and R1 to get a sort of index of how transmissible is the disease to the population. But and this is just a simple example, but you can see that, for example, in the case of the UK government, they use compartmental models, at least initially, and instead of having just three variables or three compartments, they were using more than 20 compartments. So obviously, the complex was exponentially more complicated, and they were using, for example, C++ for optimization of runtime and all these type of things. And there are much more information that is more widely available on the web. So you can see that starting from these simple building blocks, you can create really complicated models, which are also used actually in the real world. So moving on, you can see that an alternative to using compartmental models, as mentioned before, is to the use of these sort of processes simulations, in which you create agents. You create first an environment, and then you create agents which populate this environment, and they can walk around and then perform simulations on how this epidemic will basically evolve over time. So this paradigm is called agent-based modeling, and if you have to code it from scratch and you want to create a simulation of this kind of form, you need to probably make use of object-oriented programming. And in this case, therefore, you create, for example, a programming class called, in this case, person, and you assign them many different characteristics so that they can create basically a behavior of how different people behave in an environment and how they get in contact with the rest of the population so that the spread of diseases can be simulated. And using this type of approach can therefore enable us to keep track of the position of the different individuals in the populations and attribute them different characteristics such as an age, a daily income, and so on, so that you can create even more complicated simulations. So, for example, simulate if someone gets infected and has to quarantine as on his own and can't work, does he need financial support or not, depending on what's his age, what's his direction, depending on does he live in a really expensive area, does he live in a not expensive area, or how much money does he have in a bank account, and so on. So you can create this really complicated model to try to account for anything possible that a person might have and any need it might need in order to overcome these sort of problems. And similar results can also be obtained using the standard compartmental models by converting the ordinary differential equations, which I showed before, into partial differential equations and making them depending on not just on time, but for example, on space or other variables which you are working against. So then you can see that I provided here on the right side a simple algorithm which was about using to create the most basic simulation which you got up. So you, for example, initiate some variables in order to simulate the contact ratios of how close you have to be with someone in order to get the disease spread between two people, how likely it is actually that the disease will spread if you are close enough, the probability of dying, and so on. And then you can create a sort of loops so that you can simulate, create a simulation over days, over each individual in the populations, and then create this sort of conditional logic in order to grow. If someone is infected, what's the possible scenario for him? If someone is susceptible, what's the possible scenario for him, and so on. And then moving from this sort of simple base code, you can go on and create much more complicated simulations and models so that you can add more complexity and more make your environment more realistic to how actually things work in the real life. And on the left side, instead, you can see a simple example of the output from running this piece of code. And you will see that you have the same type of similar simulations as you had before using compartmental models with the same type of behavior in the core. So you start with the vast majority of populations being susceptible, just a couple of infected, and then you can see that as the days goes on in simulations, you have the number of infected going up in an exponential trend. And once most of the majority of the population has already been infected, you start seeing this exponential trend changing to reaching an inflection point and becoming a logistic trend, and therefore it's moving down. And additionally to what shown before, there is also a compartment for people who died for the simulation. But later on, I'm going to give you an actual example of the dashboard, so you can have a play of creating this model and seeing how the simulation works out. And apart from that, because we're using not just the compartments, but also we create a sort of physical environment in which agents can move, you can see that there is a graph at the bottom in which you can see the different individuals, which are colored according to their state, and you can see how they move within their city and when they get infected or not during the simulation. And in this case, I decided to create this sort of agent-based models from scratch, since it was, for my simulation, would have been the best way possible, considering that I was trying to create a highly customizable environment that I could then deploy online. But if you want to get started with agent-based models, and you have some familiarity with programming languages such as Python, but you don't want to spend too much time coding from scratch and spending too much time into implementing a solution, there are different libraries and products which are available in order to solve this problem. So two open source solutions are Mesa and Ash, which I'm going to show you in a moment. And instead, for people who actually don't know how to code and or are not interested in how coding, there are also some free products which you can download online. One is called AnyLogic, which is a software for creating simulations. And another which offers a free and a paid service, but the free service can be quite good in order to get a start and to creating these sort of scenarios. And then another service called the Blender, which is used for usually graphics design, but you can also, has also a Python API, which you can call in order to create more complicated situations, basically. So, as I mentioned before, one of the free tools is called Mesa. And you can see here another project which I created using Mesa. So in this case, I didn't have to code much at all, and just with some few lines of code, I created this forest fire simulation. So as you can see from the two videos, on the right side, you can see basically sort of a basic 2D representation of a forest. And you can see that you start with a few red trees which are burning, and then you can see how these trees, because they're closely attached to each other, can lead to a really big forest fire. And instead, on the left side, you can see how the number of healthy trees goes down as the fire expands, and therefore the number of dead trees increases. And then finally, there was also this other tool which you can use if you want to get started with this problem, which is called Ash. And you can see here the same equivalent forest fire simulation. You can see that you have these three green trees, which are the healthy trees, which are growing. So as a, for example, this can be a simulation throughout the years, and you have different trees which grow in the forest, but because the trees and some of them that which burst down, for example, during the summer, if the weather is too hot or if any accident appears in the forest. But because the proximity within the trees is not set to be too high, you can see that they just get some of the trees around them, but not all of them. And therefore, over the days and the years, the other trees can start again growing up and expanding the forest again. Okay, so we're now ready to move on to the evidence modeling case study which I created. So this case study is basically was created by me in 2020 and it's completely based on after the events of COVID-19 in early 2020. One of the main problems which people were trying to solve during the early stage of the pandemic was that there was obviously no data about how this disease was infectious, how fast it would be spreading, what would have been the consequences, how many people would need hospitalization, and so on. So the decision makers and the governments had no data which they could abuse in order to make decisions, because they were at the first month or two of the pandemic, you had really little information which governments were trying to exchange with each other, but obviously no clear data of how bad this situation would have been if you take one action or another. And basically, when I decided to approach this problem, I thought of the wider scenarios of how it could be possible to make estimates and predictions for situations which we don't have any form of data available. And this can be much more common than we would normally think, and that's not just related to COVID. So, for example, you can consider as another thought experiment. You are working now as a data scientist for a local authority, and you're asked to find a way in order to optimize how the evacuation plan should work in case of a natural disaster in your city. So you might have, for example, a volcanic eruption, an earthquake, or all these kind of situations. And obviously, when you try to plan on how the evacuation plan should work, you need to take into account how many people there are in your city and how bad it could be the impact of this volcanic eruption or earthquake and all these other natural disasters which could happen. And because these natural disasters don't tend to happen too frequently, fortunately, we don't have much data about them. So, for example, you might have a volcanic eruption happening 10,000 years ago, and another one happening 2,000 years ago, and so on. And you don't know, you probably know from what people wrote in the past how bad it was, but you don't have any actual data of how fast, the lava was spreading around and so on. So in this case, the only thing you can do is to try to create a model able to summarize to a good extent the key characteristics of the real world environment, and then use this model in order to run simulations from which you can generate data in order to create different scenarios. So you can create, for example, you create a model which takes into account, for example, how the volcanoes how the lava is spreading through a volcano, and then measure, for example, also how the environment around the volcano is. So, for example, if there are houses which are in close proximity and so on, and therefore create this sort of mathematical simulations which you can run on a computer and then generate data from there and make decision of what you should actually best do. And then depending on different scenarios, then you will find different responses. So, for example, you can do scenario A. If the volcano eruptions happens at this point in the summer, it's best to act in this way. If it happens instead in the winter, it might be better to act in this other way, and so on. And because obviously you might have some data, some form of parameters, not data, but parameters which you can play with, even by, for example, by scientists checking how active the volcano is and so on. You can make estimates of the parameters which you can then use for your simulations, but they might obviously not be too accurate, and therefore you will definitely have some form of confidence intervals which you love to play with. But at the same time, that's the best you can do in this case if you don't have any data possible. And from there on, if you actually get data later on, you can then tweak your models according to the parameters you get from the real environment. So I'm now gonna introduce you to the web application which I mentioned before that I created for COVID-19. So in this case, I created this sort of web application, which was deployed on Amazon Web Services on a EC2 instance. And I use Streamlit for the interface. Then there is also Docker support. So that means that the code is completely open source. So if you want to download the instance, you can, and then you can play with the dashboard on your machine. And for the updates of the cases of COVID-19, this application fetches data every 24 hours. And instead, there are also news updates which are fetched every 2 hours, as we'll see in a moment. So I can now move on and show you the application. Okay, so you should be able to see now the dashboard. So you can see now I'm running just on localhost for memory to make sure that there are no problems online or connection. And there is here, of course, you start with the home. So where there is an introduction of what is the dashboard for and how it can be used. And then you can see here on this side is that there are many different sections. So for example, you can start by going to World View to get a view of how COVID-19 is spreading all around the world and so on. Then you can see that there are news. So you can fetch real-time news about COVID around the world from many different countries. Then there is an explanation of how disease spreads usually. So how, what kind of patterns they follow. And this can be usually interpreted by first an exponential trend, which then converts to a logistics trend once you reach an inflection point, which can be reached either by vaccination or through herd immunity. Then you can see that there are the different sections for the different modeling simulations which I talked to you so far. So the first half, so population modeling, track and trace, central hubs, and financial simulations are all based on agent-based modeling paradigm. And instead the other half here, the SIR and sale modeling techniques, advanced sale modeling, vaccination modeling, coronavirus modeling are all based on using the compartmental modeling techniques. And finally, there is also a section here regarding A-B testing. So this is what's used in order to get feedback from the users of which kind of modeling scenario they think was most useful and which one able to choose and if they were decision makers. So that we get actually a response from the people using this dashboard. And then here, there are also a link to the repo if you want to use to see the code and a link to my website in case you have any questions or any feedback about the modeling. So yeah, now we are now on the world view. So as you can see here, you can see in real time the number of cases that there have been so far for COVID around the world, how many people recovered, how many people died. And then you have also this set of graphs summarizing, for example, how the COVID is spread all around the world. You can zoom in, you can see each individual country, the latitude, the number of confirmed cases, and so on, so that you get a clear view of how the situation is evolving and how things are good or bad in each different country. And moving on, you can see that there is also here a section with the estimated community cases and deaths for the top 10 countries which are currently having cases and the number of populations. And then you can also see the change in number of deaths and so on in the last 24 hours to see if there is a positive trends in the number of cases and deaths, or if it is a negative going trends if the cases are going down, and so on. And then here there is also sections which you can see if you press play. I wouldn't know because it starts from early 2020. And you can see, for example, now that the first hotspot was in China, and then after, as I press play, we start seeing how the crisis spread all around the world. It will just take a bit of time to run through the simulation since that it has a lot of data, but you can see that, for example, if I simply step through it, you see that the different colors automatically change depending of how the cases are changing all around the world, as you can see now, for example, here. And the same can be done for the not just the number of cases, but also the number of people recovered and people who died for the disease, so that you can get an idea of, for example, of when there are peaks in countries of, and therefore when people or countries are struggling more or less. So Moving on to the next sections, you can now see the section about the world news. So in this case, I choose the kingdom as default, and you see that fortunately there are not many news in the UK right now, but we could try to pick any other country, such as, for example, the United States, and you'll see, that here, for example, there are some news that are now loading. So, for example, you can see one article about Fauci, this one about Arizona, and so on. And then after, once you get the news, you also get a really nice summary of in the form of a workout of what were the keywords associated with the news today in the country, and also what was the overall sentiment using natural language processing. So you can see that the sentiment about COVID seems to be quite negative today in the US. Then as I mentioned before, there is also here a section about how the disease grew and expanded throughout time, and therefore if you are not sure or you don't know how disease usually spreads, there is here a simple explanation about some of the key factors which you should take into account, and some graphs summarizing how things change over time. So for example here, one really nice graph explaining how the cases might change over time is by taking, for example, in consideration the different number of weeks, the number of cases, and then plotting the results into a log scale, which emphasize changes. So, for example, if I convert this graph into a linear scale, you can see that it doesn't give you any information at all, almost. So you can see, for example, that obviously, in this case, Brazil has been, and the United States, because of the population, has been shooting a bit higher than the other ones, but apart from that, the other lines are pretty close to each other, so you'll not be able to see the actual difference in cases. Instead, if you plot into a log scale, you can actually clearly see, for example, that how applying different restrictions or different decisions by the governments helps in shaping and changing the curves, which then lead to a lower number of cases. So, for example, you can clearly see that around here was probably the summer period in 2020, and therefore you can see that there was this peak going down for all the different countries. And then the same can also be done for in terms of comparing the average number of confirmed cases and then calculating the difference between weeks, so to even emphasize changes even more. And finally, there is also here a simple explanation of how to consider the number of cases and then infer the curvature and the R number and the doubling time of this curvature. So in this case, you have the number of cases throughout time, and then trying to fit in a logistic function, you manage to calculate R squared was equal to 0.99 in the United States right now, and you have a doubling time of the number of cases of 73 days. So that means that if the United States situation doesn't change much in the next few days, you will have the double the number of cases as you have today in the United States in 73 days, so it will be in about 2-3 months time, which is okay. And then you have the same double analysis also for Brazil or India. So for example, in India, you can see that the doubling time right now is 221 days, so that means we expect that if India keeps doing what it's doing right now, you will probably have double the number of cases that you have right now in a year or so, 10 months or so. And then, as I mentioned before, we can now move on into the actual models, which I showed you throughout the beginning of the presentation. So here, I first provide a simple explanation of how this simulation has been created using agent-based modeling. And then here, there are all the different parameters which you can play with and tweak in order to create your perfect scenario. So if you are working, for example, to simulate just a small town, you can put, for example, the population size to the number you prefer. Then if you're simulating one disease, which might be worse than COVID, then you have a higher death probability, you can change again the parameter for death probability and see the results. You also see these contact ratios for simulating how close each other they have to be in order to make the transmission possible between one individual to another. and also probably how likely it is or not that the virus will spread if you are in close proximity to someone. And then also the factors, just population age. So if the average population age is 65 years old, obviously there will be more cases than if the population age is 40 for the case of COVID. But for other diseases, maybe also the other way around. Like it was, for example, for the Spanish flu, which seemed to get most of the people which were between 20 and 30 years old. And then you also create here, you see, for example, if making the population static or dynamic. So if you put the population to be static, setting this to true, you will simulate basically a lockdown. So people which not be moving much around, and therefore the spread should be going down. And if you set it false, then you see the simulation results. If you don't apply a lockdown, and then you get to see how many number of cases or how big the spike will be if you didn't apply nothing. And also here, you can see that by default, I selected to have just one community. But if you want to, for example, simulate if you have four cities, which they are a bit separated by each other, and you see how will the simulation result if you have these four cities and no one moves between the cities, and you see the number of cases. If you see, okay, you have these four cities, and now I want to let people be free to move between different cities and see how disease can spread between different cities or not, depending on the simulation. And then you can get the same results which I showed in the presentations before. And if you want, you can also press on the play button and then get a view of, for example, how the people are moving and therefore how the virus is spreading. And then here you get this final report saying, attend the simulations, this number of people were still successful before didn't get infected. And survive perfectly fine, number of people who are currently affected, number of people who are recovered, and number of people who died, and so on. And then there is also here the key highlight, the peak number. So you can see that at the peak of these simulations, 37 people were in the hospital in this case. And you can see, okay, is that enough for capacity for the hospital or not? And then you make decisions from there. And so this was a really simple environment in which you have just people moving around, but if you want, you can also simulate different form of intervention. So, for example, if I move to track and trace here on this side, you can see that on top there is a brief explanation of what the dashboard is about and what we're trying to solve. Then there are the same parameters as before, and then there are some more parameters extra which are added in order to try to take into account how applying track and trace in operations will work. So in this case, one way to apply it was to create a simple box in which people, this sort of quarantine area, in which all the people who had the disease had to travel to, and therefore, while traveling between the place where they got the disease to the safe place where all the people with the disease should be quarantining together, there might be some form of probability that they might infect people or not. So in this case, in the first simulations, we set this number to equal to zero, so you have a zero probability to infect other people. So in a perfect world scenario, if you apply track and trace, each people who's twice positive immediately run to the quarantine locations and they don't infect anyone else. What would be the scenario? And you can see here from the simulation results that the number of susceptible just decrease a bit, but then the virus dies out because it doesn't have anyone to infect. And that would be basically the ideal case scenario in which you have people. You start with some people infected here, you can see, and then every time someone results positive, immediately runs into this quarantine area here at the bottom, and therefore avoids spreading disease to other people, and the population keeps moving fine and living their life into the rest of the environment. And then here he said that to make it more realistic, you can add this probability of getting untracked. So this may be people who, for example, they are positive, but they don't get tested and therefore they keep going spreading the disease around, or maybe people who they test positive, but while they test positive, they didn't act really fast enough to move into the quarantine area and they spread a bit the disease to other people. And you can see here that in this case, you get worse, there's also a higher number of people, and the disease, instead of dying out completely, instead of a pandemic, becomes endemic and keeps circling around the population, even if it's not at two high levels, basically. And you can repeat this same form of simulations for creating different type of environments and restrictions. So another one could be central hubs. Central hubs can be, for example, if you decide to apply lockdown, but you keep people moving, free to move into a central hub, which can be, for example, going to a supermarket. So you might have all the different shops shut down and so on, but people still keep going to one central location supermarket. If one case escapes from one location and go to the supermarket, someone that is positive, how will that affect the overall population through the other cities? And then you can get this kind of simulation results from there, so you can see how the curves change, how when people run to this central location, which is this supermarket, and you can see how then the disease might start from one hub and then it moves from all the other hubs. And once you're done with that, you can see that you have some cases with just one or two communities, and then because the different people are moving to the central hubs, the disease spreads within the other communities, and now all four of them now have cases. Then you can go on and also create, for example, other type of simulations which are related to finance, and then SIR, compartmental model, which I showed you before, which I can quickly show you now. So you have the equations here. So we're not using any more algebra-based modeling, but in this case, we're using the mathematical equations in order to summarize how the different compartments should be composed and how the different people can move within compartments. And you can see the same type of curves which I showed you before. Then here, there are also scenarios for vaccination, time-limited immunity, and so on, so that you can make things even more realistic. But for a matter of times, today, we're not gonna show you that. And I just quickly want to show you instead how can these kind of models be applied instead to cases all around the world, for countries. So you can see here in this section, we have coronavirus modeling, and you have this type of dropdown in which you can select many different countries all around the world. So for example, if you live in one place and you want to see how things might, you think might go, and you want to tweak some parameters to see how the government thinks might respond, you can do it from here, and you can see, for example, by default, the first in the alphabetical order was Afghanistan, therefore it's here, but you can just use a drop in order to automatically change the results. So you can see that it's completely customized for each country, and it starts with Afghanistan with the number of cases, estimated cases, which is higher than the number of cases because people get untracked, number of recoveries, number of deaths, and so on. And then here, there is also this form of natural language processing going on behind the scenes with automatically substituting the name of the countries with the number of populations and so on in order to create the dashboard and keep everything running. And then this simulation also keeps a track of, for example, how the number of deaths, of beds, for example, how many number of beds available there are in hospital in Afghanistan, and when the simulations give you a peak, which goes higher to the availability in the hospitals, then gives you an alert so that you can try to use other parameters to reduce the number of cases to then bring the number below the number of beds available in hospitals so that you can tightly respond to the crisis, basically. And yes, so you can see here the cumulative results over time of Afghanistan, the population age, which is another factor. So you can see that in Afghanistan there are many young people, but in other countries might be the opposite. So for example, in Italy, there are many, the average age is more about 50 years old than 30 or 20, which would be in this case. And then you get the results for the different simulations here. So you have all the different parameters, as I mentioned before. So I think that basically summarizes my demonstration for today.